pictures of happy babies. So the New England Wildlife Center, this is the facility that I worked at. It was the first LEED building in the state of Massachusetts, which has to do with, we have recycled floors and I don't know, it's very good for the environment. So this picture is actually me feeding a baby screech owl. And I put the other ones there just for comparison for size. But so anyway, I came into wildlife medicine not having any experience with animals at all. I had a really hard time getting experience. And I did an internship here and they offered me a position as a tech, and most of my time was spent not knowing what I was doing. Kind of the way that I feel here. But you fake it till you make it. And by the time I left and came here, I go home every break and I work there, and I definitely knew what I was doing by the end. But I have to say that wildlife medicine is exciting. Every day is an adventure. You never know what is gonna walk through that door. You never know what you're gonna do. People will call you about the most ridiculous things, and then it's just really exciting. It is, it's not the same thing every day. You have to kind of MacGyver things. There's no set rules. I mean, even the formularies that we have are going off of information from other things that's extrapolated out to these exotic species or wildlife. So you're literally making up the rules as you go. Has anybody ever seen a baby skunk? Because I had never seen one, and I didn't realize that their skin is actually those colors. So it's amazing the things that you learn. So I want to talk a little bit about some of the bad days. My time there was amazing. This is actually what I want to do for the rest of my life, but there were mornings where I would go in and there would be a possum that was hit by a car. And so my morning started out with me removing 12 babies from the pouch. That's another thing when you guys are home in the States, if you see animals like that on the side of the road that have been hit, take 2 minutes and check and see if it's a mom and see if they can do something, because otherwise those babies are inside and mom's dead on the side of the road. But the problem is in wildlife medicine, we have no money for the most part, because most of the places that do it are not funded by the government. And you have to have some criteria for the way that you're gonna work and the things that you're gonna do. We normally have a 3-strike rule for animals that come in. If they have 3 major problems, they're gonna get euthanized. Like if you have multiple fractures and then pneumonia on top of it. But with babies, we normally try and give all of them a chance, with the exception of possums that don't have fur, we tend to euthanize or see if there's a private rehabber that will take them, because we just can't, you don't have the time. And I know from personal experience why they make these rules. When I was interning there, we were working 12 to 14 hour shifts, even though it was stated it was a 9-to-5, and we had more babies. We probably had 25 to 30 baby squirrels. We probably had 10 baby raccoons. We had a full medical ward. And I think we might have had some baby birds. And someone brought in a container full of, I think it was 12 baby mice. We didn't know what they were at the time. Like, just because they were so small. When you work with baby animals, you can't always tell what they are until they get a little bit bigger. But there were 12 baby mice, and the vets were kind of like, all right, well, we're probably gonna euthanize them because you guys are overworked as is, you can barely get the work done. And everybody wants to save every animal. And I can't tell you how many times I've been told that you can't save them all. And it doesn't stop me from trying. It doesn't stop the people that I've worked with from trying. So we said no. They let us make the call, and we decided to keep those 12. And most of them died over the course of a week, and it took away from the work that we could have been doing. So I know why they make those choices, but they're hard choices. And it's even harder when your day starts out with pulling baby possums that could have a chance and euthanizing them because you don't have time. Here's a happy story. This is a bullfrog. This is my interns affectionately named him Trevor. And we amputated one of his hind legs at the knee, right above where the femur is. And he was fine. But he came in with like degloving and necrosis. And so another thing about wildlife medicine and medicine in general wildlife medicine. Normally vets and the people who work with them are of two minds. I had two vets that worked in the same place, and one of them said basically, don't name anything. Don't name it. Don't get attached. Everything dies anyway. And it does give you a distance, and it does sometimes help. But my other vet who worked at the same place was like, name everything whatever you want, because once you name something, you care for it better. And it is true for some people, not everyone. Me, I'll care for it whether it has a name or an accession number. I don't care. But some people are more vested once you give it a name. So that was Trevor. All right, this is another sad story. So, working in wildlife, you get to see these amazing, a lot of times endangered or threatened animals, and it's amazing to be able to treat them and then let them go, but they don't all get let go. This is a piping plover, which is actually, they're either endangered or like critically threatened in the state of Massachusetts, and it's a chick, obviously. It came in, it was circling, and ataxic, and we tried everything that we could, but it died in my hands. So, and sometimes that makes it harder. I don't know what it is that it being something that's threatened and losing that, and probably because there's so much going on that we're just like continually losing things and we're fighting so hard to keep, you know, science at the forefront of what we're doing. But so some of the stories are really sad. When I was a little girl, I've always wanted to be a vet, but I wanted to specifically work with like nursery zoo animals. And until I started wildlife medicine, I didn't realize that like this is the best of both worlds, because you literally have babies most of the time twice a year. Squirrels have two baby seasons, one in the spring and one in the fall. And then you get to watch them grow, and then you release them, and they go into the wild and they live, which is amazing. So it's so much better than my original idea of taking care of zoo animals, which are just in a cage. So just talking a little bit about being MacGyvers, I'm not sure what type of bird that was. I'm sure I knew at one point, but it had a broken wing, which is why it has the wing wrap on, but you can see how tiny that is. And the x-ray on the left is actually a hummingbird that I went into rounds one morning, and my boss is like, hey, so Jean, can you take some x-rays of the hummingbird today? And we don't have dental x-rays. It was a giant plate. So it's exciting. There's just babies. I think I just have, has anybody seen that type of an x-ray before, by the way, being taken?
Oh, yeah.
The one on the right. So if you work with birds of any sort, you're gonna need to learn how to do it, and it is not fun, and it's probably, I hate them. But they're really important to show fractures and the wing, and what you have to do is hold the animal upside down, and you have lead gloves on. I don't know if you can see them, the picture's kind of dark, and then you stretch their wing over the plate so that you get a straight up and down view of the wing. And then the goose, the Canadian goose on the top, had come in with an arrow straight through its head. That's what the hole is. The arrow was still in its head when it came in. I couldn't find any other pictures that I had of it. And it somehow just missed everything. It literally took a little tiny piece of the lower jaw, but it ended up being fine. So we would just clean every day, and the hole would get smaller and smaller, and then it was finally released, which was pretty amazing. So this picture is really important to me. The last group of raccoons that I got to work with, this was the first release I ever went on. So we normally release everything just wherever. There are a lot of rules regarding where you release wild animals. They're supposed to be, like, in Massachusetts, they're supposed to be within 5 miles of where they were caught, unless it's like a shopping mall, which sometimes it is, or near your facility, like within a certain area. So, but the raccoons go to a specific state park and round them up and vaccinate them before they leave. So because it was my last big hurrah, I got to go with them to release the 16 raccoons that we had had from that season. And that's the picture that I took. And so the other facility that I worked at, I volunteer at, is called the National Marine Life Center, and they work with seals and sea turtles. They see mainly Kent's Ridley is what we see, which are one of the also endangered species of sea turtles. They see 4 different types of seals. I don't know if I'm gonna remember them all. There's harbor, carp, gray. Definitely don't remember them. But there's 4 types of seals. The gray seals are the meanest. And there's just a picture as we, there's a sea, Kemp's Ridley that was brought to my facility to do x-rays on. And can you see the, I don't even know what it's called, like the syringe? Those are like $80 a piece. The thing that I'm using to feed, and they're plastic and they break easily. So this is another facility that like doesn't have any money and yet has to spend it on things like that, and then volunteers like me come in and drop it on the floor and break it. Things happen. There's just more of the seals that I've gotten to work with. And then that's